وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى We're going to carry on the explanation of the kitab أخلاق حملتي القرآن written by الإمام أبو بكر محمد بن الحسين الآجري رحمه الله The author رحمه الله he said حدثنا أبو جعفر أحمد بن يحيى الحلواني قال حدثنا يحيى بن عبد الحميد الحماني قال حدثنا حماد بن شعيب عن عاصم عن زر عن عبد الله بن عمرو رضي الله تعالى عنهما عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يقال لصاحب القرآن يوم القيامة اقرأ وارقى في الدرجات ورتل ورتل كما كنت ترتل في الدنيا فإن منزلتك عند آخر آية كنت تقرأها وأخبرنا أبو عبد الله أحمد بن الحسن بن عبد الجبار الصوفي قال حدثنا شجاع بن مخلد شجاع بن مخلد قال حدثنا الفضل بن دكين قال حدثنا سفيان عن عاصم عن زر عن عبد الله بن عمرو رضي الله تعالى عنهما عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يقال اقرأ وارقى ورتل كما كنت ترتل في الدنيا فإن منزلك عند آخر آية كنت تقرأها قال محمد بن الحسين وروي عن أم الدرداء أنها قالت سألت عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها عمن دخل الجنة ممن قرأ القرآن ما فضله على من لم يقرأه فقالت عائشة إن عدد درج الجنة بعدد آي القرآن فمن دخل الجنة ممن قرأ القرآن فليس فوقه أحد الإمام الأجري رحمه الله He is speaking about the virtues of the carriers of the Qur'an And in our previous episode We mentioned from the virtues of the people of the Qur'an is that they are from the people of Allah. يعني أهل القرآن are أهل الله وخاصته. That the people who are carrying the Qur'an علماً وعملاً وفهماً that they have the knowledge of it and they have the actions backing the knowledge of the Qur'an those people are the people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here now he goes on to another virtue of the people of the Qur'an. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. And when a companion and his father, both of them are companions, يعني the son and the father are both companions, what the scholars of hadith say is radiyallahu anhuma. May Allah be pleased with both of them. يعني may Allah be pleased with Abdullah, the son, and his father Amr ibn As. Both of them are two noble companions. That the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Yuqalu," it will be said, "لصاحب القرآن," it will be said to the people of the Quran. يعني صاحب القرآن here means, as we mentioned, the one who is consistent upon the wordings of the Quran. يعني he consistently protects and safeguards and takes care of the articulation of the wording of the Quran. And he also gives great importance to the meaning of the Qur'an. And he also makes sure that he implements what the Qur'an instructs him to do and stays away from that which the Qur'an tells him to stay away from. That's Sahibul Qur'an, Ahlul Qur'an. Those are the names that they have. That person, it will be said to him, يوم القيامة, يوم القيامة. The day of judgment, it will be said to that person, اقرأ, recite. The word iqra is amrun bi qira'ati al-Qur'an. It will be said to that person, recite the Qur'an. Here's a question. The Prophet ﷺ is saying, the day of judgment, The person, it will be said to him, read. Question. Is the day of judgment Daru Taklif? Is the day of judgment, because the word Iqra is Amrun biqira'ati al-Quran. And this person is being commanded to recite the Quran. And that we know from the commands is obligation. Yani the command, what do we take from it? Al-Amru yaqtadi al-wujub. That the commands show obligation. Is there such a thing, Yawm al-Qiyamah, called wajib, haram, halal, makruh? Yani is the day of judgment a place of taklif? Yani when we take the ahkam, we divide the ahkam into two, right? Ahkam wad'iyah and ahkam taklifiyah. Ahkam taklifiyah means in this world, there is halal, there is haram, there is dislike, there is permissible, there is recommended. Yani there are those things. It's called daru taklif. Yawm al-Qiyamah is not daru taklif. Yawm al-Qiyamah is darul jaza. Scholars mentioned that it's a day of accountability, recompensing a person for what he said, what he did, wa ma ila dhalik. So how do we reconcile between that and this statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that it will be said to the person of the Quran, recite, and you have to recite? Scholars responded to that and they said that what it means here is that it means at-tana'um wa at-taladhdhud. And the person of the Quran will be said, enjoy the Quran. It is not command to do it, is enjoy the recitation of the Quran. And the person wouldn't even object against it. It wouldn't be a burden on him. Yani sometimes the commandments here in this world, it might be a pressure, a burden on you to do it. Like in there, when you're told to do something, it's not a burden. It's actually something you enjoy. The nafs would like to do it. So it's not a burden on the person anymore. Even if they're instructed to do something, they'll find ease and simplicity in doing it. They'll enjoy it to recite the Quran. It will be said to the person of the Quran, Iqra, recite. Warqa. We have here, Warqa. What does the word Warqa mean? Warqa means ascend. Go up, ascend, go up. Don't read it as Warqi. And put a kasra on the qaf. Why? Is what distinguishes two wordings, two meanings that come from the word. And if you read it as warqa, it means ascend. And if you read it as warqi, it means do ruqya. Because it comes from the word, the three-letter word, which is raqa, yarqa, that's it comes from. And in Arabic you say irqa, irqi. The difference between them is here. If you want to say to a person, ascend, go up, you say to them, irqa, go up. And if you want to say to a person, do ruqya on someone, and you want to command them to do ruqya, you say, irqi, irqi. So here it's not ruqya, it's to say, here's what? Is to go up, ascend. You say, so it will be said to the person, iqra, read, warqa, ascend, fi darajati, in the levels. And then Jannah has darajat, because it goes up. And Jahannam has what? Darakat. Darakat. Jahannam has what? Jahannam has darakat. That's what Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala said. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala said in the Quran, Inna al-munafiqina fi darkil asfali min al-nar. Darkil asfali min al-nar. And Jahannam has got darakat. And then Jannah has what? Darajat. Darajat. It will be said to that person, go up and ascend. The people of Jannah are of levels. They're not the same. The people of Jannah are not the same. They are of different levels. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He told us in the Quran, وَلِكُلِّنْ دَرَجَاتٍ مِّمَّا عَمِلُوا وَلِيُوَفِّيَهُمْ أَعْمَالَهُمْ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, every single person is in a level in Jannah because of their actions. وَلِكُلِّنْ دَرَجَاتٌ مِّمَّا عَمِلُوا. Everyone is in Jannah in accordance to their actions. مِمَّا عَمِلُوا وَلِيُوَفِّيَهُمْ أَعْمَالَهُمْ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. And everybody will be accounted for their actions يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. They're not going to be oppressed. So this ayah clearly shows us وَلِكُلِّنْ دَرَجَاتٌ مِّمَّا عَمِلُوا, that every action is in accordance, so every level is in accordance to the people's actions. So people are not the same in Jannah. Warqa fi darajat, go up in levels. Warattil and recite, kama kunta turattilu fi dunya, the way you used to recite in the dunya. Read like you used to read in the dunya. Here it says, warattil, recite. This person, he used to read slowly, he used to read calmly. He never used to go against the tajweed and the med and everything. He's going to do that. فَإِنَّ مَنْزِلَتَكَ, your house, your place of residency is going to be what? عِنْدَ آخِرِ آيَةٍ كُنْتَ تَقْرَأُهَا, it's going to be the last place you recite. Ibn al-Qayyim said, رحمه الله تعالى, he said, اقرأ وارقى فإن منزلتك عند آخر آية كنت تقرأها. Ibn al-Qayyim said, this يحتمل شيئين. It can mean one of two meanings. Ibn al-Qayyim is saying, read, recite, ascend whilst reading and reciting, for verily your last station, your place of residency is going to be the last verse that you recite. Ibn al-Qayyim said this wording of the Prophet, يَحْتَمِلُ شَيْئَيْنِ, it can take two meanings. One of two meanings. أَن تَكُونَ مَنْزِلَتُهُ عِنْدَ آخِرِ حِفْظِهِ, that wherever your memorization stops you is where you're going to stay. And a person just knows Juz'amah, when he finishes Juz'amah, that's where he's going to live, in Jannah. That's one meaning. And that's the common meaning that everybody takes from the hadith, which is, it's in accordance to your memorization, how much of the Qur'an that you've memorized. The person will stop according to their memorization. That's the first meaning, he said. The second, he says, وَأَن تَكُونَ عِنْدَ آخِرِ تِلَاوَةِ لِمَحْفُوظِهِ, and the last one is, وَأَن تَكُونَ, that it means, أَن تَكُونَ عِنْدَ آخِرِ تِلَاوَةِ, the last place he actually recited when he had memorized it. What's the difference? Sheikh Abdul Razak al-Badr explains to us the difference between the two. Sheikh Abdul Razak says, وَهَذَا فِيهِ تَفَاوُتْ, the two is different. لِأَنَّهُ قَدْ يَحْفَظُ وَلَكِنْ لَا يَتْرُ مَا يَحْفَظُ, the person, maybe he's memorized something, but he doesn't recite what he memorized. He doesn't give importance to it. A person has memorized the Qur'an, but he doesn't recite it, what he memorized. He doesn't give a lot of consideration to it, or he gives no consideration to it. ففي المعنى الثاني, then that is the second meaning. وأن تكون عند تلاوتي لمحفوظي, it's according to your what you've memorized, not what you've read. Okay? Whereas the other one is referring to the person who recited the Qur'an, kept reciting the Qur'an, that's what it means, he said. The author then, rahimahullah, he says, وَأَخْبَرَنَا أَبُو عَبْدِ اللَّهِ أَحْمَدُ بْنُ الْحُسَيْنِ مِنْ عَبْدِ الْجَبَّارَ الصُّوفِيُّ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا شُجَاعِ بْنُ مَخْلَدٍ قَالَ, he said, حَدَّثَنَا الْفَضْلُ بْنُ دُكَيْنٍ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا سُفْيَانُ. Fadl ibn Dukayn here is Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn. And Fadl ibn Dukayn here is Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn, the Shaykh of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Yahya ibn Ma'in and Wama ila. And other than those two noble Imams, Mughayrih min Ahl al-Ilm. Al Fadl ibn Dukayn, whenever you see, write this side benefit. It's good mas'ala, ilmiya, hadithiya. It's a beneficial thing related to hadith, which is, whenever you see Al-Fadl ibn Dukayn, Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn, narrating from Sufyan, which Sufyan is it? Is it Sufyan ibn Uyayna or is it Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri? You have to ask yourself this question. Sufyan ibn Uyayna or Sufyan al-Thawri? Which one is it? If you see Al-Fadl ibn Dukayn, Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn, narrating from Sufyan, then it's Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri. Okay? Remember that all the time. An Asimin, narrating from Asim, and Zirrin, from Zir, and Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Asin, radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, may Allah be pleased with him, and in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yuqalu, it will be said. Again, where is the multaqa sanad? Where does the sanad meet the previous sanad? Asim narrated to who? Hamad ibn Shu'aybin, and he also narrated to Sufyan al-Thawri. Asim narrated, Asim, his student is Sufyan al-Thawri, and also from his student is Hamad ibn Shu'aybin. So there's going to be slight difference in the wordings. The difference of the wording either is the wording of Sufyan al-Thawri or the wording of who? Hamad ibn Shu'aybin. Sufyan al-Thawri's wording is yuqalu qara, it will be said to the person. Iqra, read. Warqa, and ascend. Waratil, and read. Kama kunta turattilu fi dunya. Fa inna manzilaka. So the previous one was what? The previous was warqa fi darajat. Now this is, it doesn't have that warqa fi darajat. Also, this one says fa'inna manzilaka. And the previous one was fa'inna manzilataka. There was a ta in there. Inda akhiri ayatin kunta taqra'uha. Qala Muhammad ibn al-Husayn. Who is the Muhammad ibn al-Husayn here? Muhammad ibn al-Husayn here is the author of the book, Abu Bakr. Muhammad ibn Husayn al-Ajurri al-Baghdadi rahimahullah, al-Imam al-Ajurri. He says, warwiya, it was narrated. Warwiya, it was narrated. The scholars of hadith, when they use the word warwiya, this is called sighatu tamrid. Ruwiya, qila, dukira. These words, when you see them, it's called sighatu tamrid. In ilm al-hadith, it's sighatu tamrid. When the scholars of hadith say ruwiya, qila, dhukira, they mean this hadith is graded weak according to them. So Imam al-Ajurri is already telling us this hadith is weak. And it is weak. Imam Hakim ibn Isaburi narrated it in Mustadrak. Ibn Abi Shayba narrated it. Okay. Imam al-Bayhaqi narrated it in Shu'ab al-Iman. And Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah weakened it. And he says that hadith is da'ifa. Sheikh al-Bani weakened it there. And he also mentioned this hadith is sahiha. So the hadith we say, لا يصح موقوفا ولا يصح مرفوعا. This hadith is not sahih as Aisha's wording, and it's also not sahih as the Prophet's wording. Okay, and I'll explain why. قال محمد بن الحسين, he said, وروية, it was narrated عن أم الدرداء, from our mother أم الدرداء, أنها قالت, that she said, سألت, I asked عائشة رضي الله عنها, I asked Aisha, the daughter of who? Abu Bakr الصديق. Aisha is the daughter of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. And Aisha is the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Ummu Darda is saying, I asked Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. She asked her about what? Amman daqal al-jannata, the person who enters Jannah. Mimman qara'a al-Qur'an, the one who has recited the Qur'an. Ma fadluhu, what is his virtue? Ala man lam yaqra'uhu, what is his virtue over the one who hasn't recited the Qur'an? Faqalat Aisha, she said, inna adada darajil jannah, the levels of Jannah are bi'adadi ayil Qur'an, is in accordance to the what? Is the Qur'an, the verses of the Qur'an, the ayat of the Qur'an, the number of verses there are the levels of Jannah. Again, the scholars don't all agree on the adad of the Qur'an, right? The adad of the Qur'an is not agreed upon. There's an adad called, there's called the Adul Kufi and there's the Adul Basri. The Kufiyin and the Basriyin, they differ in the counting of the Quran. By the way, when they differ on the counting of the Quran, no one's pulling out an extra verse from somewhere. That's not what's happening. It's just that, is this two verses or is it just one verse? That's what they're arguing about. Okay? Like, for example, Surah Al-Fatiha. So there's difference of opinion when it comes to the adad of the ayat of the Quran. Ala kullin, Aisha is saying that the darajat of Jannah, the levels of Jannah are in accordance to the levels of the verses in the Quran. Aisha then says, فَمَنْ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةَ مِمَّنْ قَرَأَ الْقُرْآنَ فَلَيْسَ فَوْقَهُ أَحَدٌ. What about if a person recites the whole Quran? He read the whole entire Quran when he was commanded. And he was said, اقرأ ورقة في الدرجات. read and ascend, this person, if he finishes the Qur'an, there's a level, no one's higher than him. This I said before, it's not authentic. Abu Bakr al-Bayhaqi narrated in Shu'ab al-Iman, Hakim narrated, Ibn Abi Shayba, and other great scholars have narrated it, and this hadith is weak, mawqufan wa marfu'an. Aisha never said this. It's not authentically attributed to her. If it was authentically attributed to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, then it would have been what? Mawqufu lafdan marfu'u hukman. If Aisha authentically was transmitted from her, then we would say that this hadith is the wording of Aisha, but it has the ruling of marfu'. Meaning it's got the ruling as though the Prophet ﷺ said it, because this is mimma la majala lil-ra'yi fihi. It's not something Aisha could have known from ijtihad or independent reasoning. Something that she can only have taken it from a text. Yani, this is from the ghaybiyat, that the levels of Jannah and how much levels there are. This is taken from the Prophet ﷺ. It's not something Aisha saw. The author rahimahullah then says, حَدَّثَنَا أَبُو الْفَضْلِ جَعْفَرِ بْنُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَنْدَلِيُّ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا الْحَسَنِ بْنُ مُحَمَّدٍ زَعْفَرَانِيُّ. Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani is from the old students of Imam al-Shafi'i. Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani, he's from the old students of Imam al-Shafi'i. And Al-Hassan, the old students, when I say, what do I mean by that? And Imam al-Shafi'i has two sets of students, right? He has students that narrated from him when he was in Egypt. And he has students that narrated from him when he was what? In Iraq. The students that narrated from Imam al-Shafi'i when he was in Iraq, these are considered his old students because they are the transmitters of his old madhab, the madhab al-qadim. Like, for example, Abu Thawr, Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani, Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Ishaq ibn Rahuya. These are the students of Al-Imam al-Shafi'i at at his old madhab. So if you ever hear Ahmad ibn Hanbal attribute something to Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, it's the time when Imam Shafi'i was in Iraq, or Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani, or Abu Thawr, or لكن if Abu Ya'qub al-Buwayti, or Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani, or Al-Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi narrate from Shafi'i, then this is the madhab al-jadid, it's the new madhab, because they were the ones who took knowledge from Imam Shafi'i when he was what? In Egypt. Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani, he's actually, subhanallah, he was the reciter on Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. Yani Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, when he would explain a book, or he would explain something, there was a reciter who would recite the text onto Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, and then the Shafi'i would explain it. The reciter who used to recite on Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was who? Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani. And then, for you to read on Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, means your Arabic must be very good, right? And Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was what? He was an imam fi al-lugha. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was an imam in the Arabic language. Imam. Some scholars, they said that he's a hujjah, he's a proof in the Arabic language. And if Shafi'i spoke in a way, it was considered to be either a dialect of the Arabic language or a madhab in the Arabic language. They saw it as a proof. One of the great scholars in the Arabic language, his name is Al-Asma'i, Abdul Malik ibn Quraib. Abdul Malik ibn Quraib, Al-Asma'i, he was the one who said, he's an imam in the Arabic language. He said, I went to Shafi'i and I wrote from him the poetry of the people of Hudayl. I wrote it from Shafi'i. Or I corrected it from Al-Imam Shafi'i. Are we all together? So Al-Imam Shafi'i was an imam in the Arabic language. And for this great man, Al-Hassan Muhammad al-Za'farani, to read on Al-Imam Shafi'i means that his Arabic is good. He's not going to read something wrong on Al-Imam Shafi'i. He's not going to do lahan. And he's not going to pronounce words incorrectly. So that's who Al-Hassan Muhammad al-Za'farani is. He said, قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا عَلِيُّ بْنُ عَاصِمٍ عَنْ إِبْرَاهِيمَ الْهَجَرِيُّ عَنْ أَبِي الْأَحْوَصِ عَنْ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ بْنِ مَسْعُودٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ قَالَ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ تَعَلَّمُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ وَاتْلُوهُ فَإِنَّكُمْ تُؤْجَرُونَ عَلَى تِلَاوَتِهِ بِكُلِّ حَرْفٍ 10 حَسَنَاتٍ أَمَّا إِنِّي لَا أَقُولُ أَلِف لَام م حَرْفٌ وَلَكِنْ أَلِفٌ حَرْفٌ وَلَامٌ حَرْفٌ وَمِيمٌ حَرْفٌ إن هذا القرآن مأدبة الله فتعلموا من مأدبة الله فتعلموا من مأدبة الله أما فتعلموا من مأدبة الله ما استطعتم إن هذا القرآن هو حبل الله هو النور المبين والشفاء النافع ونجاة من اتبعه وعصمة من تمسك به لا يعوج فيقوم. The Nusq of Abdullah ibn Razak, it says what? فيقوم. The fa is his fa السببية. And the fa السببية came after the la النافية. So what is best to say is فيقوم. Instead of فيقوم, it's better to say فيقوم. ولا تنقضي عجائبه ولا يقلق عن كثرة الرد. This hadith, Al-Imam Muhammad bin Husayn al-Aajurri, Abu Bakr Muhammad bin Husayn al-Aajurri, he says, Abu al-Fadl Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sandali said, Haddathana al-Hasan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani, an Ali ibn Asim, an Ibrahim al-Hajari, an Abil Ahwas, an Abdullah ibn Mas'udin, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said what? Ta'allamu lan, hadha al-Qur'an, learn this Qur'an, watluhu, and recite it. Mm-hmm. وَتْلُوهُ recite it. So the first thing that is تَعَلَّمُوا learn the Qur'an. What does it mean learn the Qur'an? I mentioned it before. It means to learn the wording and the meaning, both of those. يعني learning the Qur'an means you learn the wording and the meaning. Okay. ولذلك the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in the hadith he said بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Convey one verse from me, right? Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not say that? He said, convey one verse on my behalf. The scholars, they mentioned that the conveying of the Qur'an means conveying its wording and conveying its meaning. And you don't convey just the wording to someone. You convey the meaning of the Qur'an. ولذلك they say, إبلاغ حروفي تحفيظا وضبطا وإبلاغ معانيه تفهيما وعقلا. It is to convey the wordings and it's also to convey the meaning. ولذلك شيخ عبد الرزاق البدر said something very powerful and I think inshallah ta'ala is worth mentioning. He says, وَلِهَذَا يُخْطِئُ مَنْ يَتَصَدَّرُ لِدَعْوَةِ النَّاسِ وَلَا يَكُونُ لَهُ فِقٌّ فِي الْقُرْآنِ. He said there's a common mistake that many people fall into. Is that they go forward to give da'wah, to call the people to the religion of Allah. وَلَا يَكُونُ and they do not have فِقْهٌ فِي الْقُرْآنِ. They have no understanding of the Qur'an. وَلَا يَعْرِفُ مَعَانِيهِ. He doesn't know the meaning of the Qur'an. وَحْكَامِهِ. He doesn't know the jurisprudent rulings in the Qur'an. فَيَقُولُ. He then says, عَلَى اللَّهِ. He says about Allah, بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. He speaks about Allah with no knowledge. وَيَخُوضُ فِي آيَاتِ اللَّهِ. And then the person indulges into the verses of Allah, بِخِلَافِ مُرَادِ اللَّهِ, in opposition to what Allah intended by this wording. وَيَظُنُّ. And then the person then thinks to himself, أَنَّ هَذَا هُوَ الْإِبْلَاغُ. Then the person thinks to himself that he's conveying the Qur'an. And Shaykh Abdul Razak is so right. There's so many people, subhanAllah, who are in the da'wah scene today. You say to them, أخي, why are you giving da'wah? You are the one who needs da'wah. Don't give da'wah to anyone. You are in need of it. أَنْتَ فِي حَاجَةٍ إِلَيْهِ. You are in more need than anyone else. Focus on yourself. Nurture yourself in understanding and comprehension of the religion, and then inshallah ta'ala, then you can give. فَاقِدُ شَيْءٍ لَا يُعْطِيهِ. One that doesn't have can't give. He will say to you, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةٍ. Convey from me, even if it's one word. We will say the conveying is conveying its wording, صحيح, and conveying its meaning. You don't know the meaning. You don't know the meaning. And so what's happening is that you're speaking about the verses without understanding what it means. And so you're speaking against Allah. You're saying other than what Allah intended, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you become more of a problem. You become more of a liability than an asset. You become a hindrance to the da'wah and you cause more problems to it. And the people of knowledge, Ahlul Ilm, they used to stay away from speaking out, speaking without knowledge. Putting themselves forward without knowledge. وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبَ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. Don't say this is halal, this is haram, without having knowledge and understanding and comprehension. There's no one worse than wallahi the person who speaks about Allah's religion with no knowledge and no understanding. The Prophet ﷺ told us in the hadith sahihain, in the hadith Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ انْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُ مِنْ صُدُورِ الرِّجَالِ وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يُبْقِ عَالِمًا اتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ رُؤُوسًا جُهَالًا فَسُئِلُوا فَأَفْتَوْا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا. That the hour will not strike until Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He takes the people of knowledge, the ignorant ones are left. When the ignorant ones are left, people think these people have understanding of the religion. They think they are people of understanding. They refer back to them and ask them questions about big matters that they should have taken to scholars and not taken it to these ignorant people. And this ignorant one doesn't know he doesn't know. He thinks he knows. And so he gives fatwa, he gives answers, he responds. He responds here, he gives answers here, answers there. And the first person he harms, number one, is himself. He causes himself harm. And then he causes harm to the other people. ولذلك the poet he said وليس في فتواه مفتي متبع ما لم يضف للعلم والدين الورع. The person you're going to take knowledge from, it has to be a person who has knowledge. يعني he's عالم, يعني he knows the deen, number one. And he's a person who's ورع, he's a person who lives by that knowledge, he's implemented it, he stays away from whatever is doubtful, he does that which is clear cut halal. And he's a person عامل بعلمه. But you don't go to كل من هب ودب كسير وعوير والثالث ليس في خير. You go to any individual you see with a imama on his head, wallahi he knows. And so you ask questions, you want to know the religion from that person, you're going to harm yourself. It's sad, wallahi, that many people today, they don't go to a doctor unless he's qualified, he's a specialist. And when you enter into the doctor's his clinic, or you enter the hospital, the doctor places his certificates and his credentials on the wall so the people come and they see it. And he's telling you, I graduated, these are my qualifications, this is what I have. Even if you go to his website, you see everything now. But when that's the doctor. And if it goes wrong, it's just a worldly harm that might happen to you. What about if you go to someone who doesn't know anything about the religion and you ask him and he tells you something and you worship Allah based on that thing and you come the day of judgment, and that isn't what Allah wanted from you. You see, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, is there anyone greater than Abu Bakr in this ummah after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? No one. Yani Abu Bakr was the most knowledgeable man after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As Abi Sa'id al-Khudri said, كان عَلَمُنَا بِرَسُولِ. That Abu Bakr knew the Prophet more than all of us. And he knew the religion more than everyone. There was only one companion who ever gave fatwa in the presence of the Prophet was Abu Bakr. And Abu Bakr used to give fatwa when the Prophet is sitting there, he used to give fatwa. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. No one else could dare to do that. Abu Bakr is saying, أَيُّ أَرْضٍ تُقِلُّنِي. Which earth is going to carry me? وَأَيُّ سَمَاءٍ تُضِلُّنِي. And which sky will shade me? إِنْ أَنَا قُلْتُ عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا أَعْلَمُ. If I say about Allah, another wording, he says, in ana qultu fi ayati Allah ma la alam. If I was to say about Allah that which I have no knowledge of. Ama in qultu fi ayati min kitabi Allah bi ra'yi aw bima la alam. If I speak about Allah's religion without no knowledge and understanding. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is saying that. Which earth is going to carry me and which sky is going to shade me? So this is something we need to be very conscious about. The conveying of Islam and the Qur'an must be someone who has the wording and the meaning. That's what it means. تَعَلَّمُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. Learn the Qur'an first. وَتْلُوهُ. And then recite it. That's when you recite it. فَإِنَّكُمْ تُؤْجَرُونَ. You'll be rewarded. عَلَى تِلَاوَتِهِ. You'll be rewarded for its recitation. بِكُلِّ حَرْفٍ عَشْرَ حَسَنَاتٍ. Every single letter, you get 10 reward for it. أَمَّا إِنِّي لَا أَقُولُ أَلِفْ لَا مِيمٌ حَرْفٌ. The Prophet said, I will not say أَلِفْ لَا مِيمٌ is a word. It's not a word. Or a letter, sorry. I won't say it's a letter. وَلَكِنْ أَلِفٌ حَرْفٌ. But أَلِفْ is a letter. وَلَامٌ حَرْفٌ. And لَام is a letter. وَمِيمٌ حَرْفٌ. And ميم is a letter. يعني, you got 30 reward. هذا القرآن مأدبة الله. This Quran is the مأدبة of Allah تبارك وتعالى. يعني مأدبة is what you is It's like a wedding, whatever you invite a person with. It's Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's invitation for you. فَتَعَلَّمُوا learn from مَأْدَبَةِ اللَّهِ. He says, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَأْدُبَةُ اللَّهِ. That this Qur'an is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inviting you. فَتَعَلَّمُوا مِنْ مَأْدَبَةِ اللَّهِ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ أَمَا مِنْ مَأْدُبَةِ اللَّهِ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ as much as you're able to. Learn from it. إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ هُوَ حَبْلُ اللَّهِ. This Qur'an is the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Qur'an is a what? It's the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هُوَ نُورُ الْمُبِينَ. The Qur'an is a light. وَالشِّفَاءُ النَّافِعُ. And the Qur'an is a beneficial cure. As Allah said, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءُ. وَنَجَاتٌ مَنِ اتَّبَعَهُ. And the Qur'an is a success for the person who follows it. You're going to be from Ahlul Najat. The people are going to succeed if you follow it. وَعِصْمَةٌ مَنْ تَمَسَّكَ بِهِ. And if you hold on to the Qur'an, you're free from mistakes and shortcomings. As long as you hold on to the Qur'an, you're not wrong, you're right. لَا يَعْوَجُّ فَيُقَوَّمَ. The Qur'an is never crooked. There's no crookedness in this Qur'an. It's straight. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala mentioned to us, He says, وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ عِوَجًا قَيِّمًا. The Qur'an, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said, we did not make it crooked. We made it straight. There's no deviation in it as well. It doesn't deviate a person. وَلَا يَنْقَضِ عَجَائِبُهُ. The Qur'an, its fascination never ends. The gems that are in the Qur'an, the amazement that is in the Qur'an never ends. It doesn't stop. It doesn't. And the Qur'an is full of amazement. وَلِذَلِكَ the jinns, what did they say? جِنُّ نَصِيبِينَ. What did they say? إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا قُرْآنًا عَجَبًا. And they saw that the Qur'an is fascination, amazement. Straight when they heard it, oh, this is amazing. So it never finishes, the Qur'an. وَلَا يَخْلَقُ عَنْ كَثْرَةِ الرَّدِّ. And the consistent repetition, okay, does not wear the Qur'an out. The Qur'an doesn't wear out. Are we all together? The Qur'an, by repeating it, it doesn't wear out. You know the clothes, if you wear it a lot, it wears out, right? The Qur'an never wears out. The more you read, the more it glows, the more it shines, the more it becomes clearer and clearer and clearer for you. ولذلك الشاطبي ودي سي سواء إن كتاب الله أوثق شافع وأغنى غناء واهبا متفضلا وخير جليس لا يمل حديثه وترداده يزداد فيه تجملا وترداده يزداد فيه تجملا. The more you repeat it, the more the beauty comes out for you. The Quran shines even more for you. This hadith is weak for two reasons. عاصم ابن الصهيب is a weak narrator. Hafiz Mahajir, he said, Suduqun yukhti wa yusirru. His teacher, who narrated from him here, his teacher, Ibrahim ibn Muslim al-Abdi, Ibrahim al-Hajri, he is also weak. Hafiz Mahajir said, layyun al-hadith. His hadith is very weak. And he even said, Hafiz Mahajir, that sometimes, a lot of the times, more like, what he does is that he takes a hadith which are mawquf and he attributes it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's a statement of a sahabi, and because of his memorization being very weak, he always attributes it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then he's a weak person. So this hadith is not authentic, it's weak. We'll stop there inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and his messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illallah astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Assalamu alaikum. If you're enjoying these videos and you'd like to keep up to date with all of the courses we're going to be running, make sure you head over to amauathome.com.